In this video, I'm going to show how to connect, power, and test fire a CO2 laser tube. Please be aware that laser radiation at these intensity levels, as well as high voltage, is quite dangerous. I'm not going to tell you what you can and cannot do at home, but at least please don't blame me for it. The laser tube used in this video has an optical output power of 50 watts and was kindly provided by Vivor. The link to the tube is provided in the video's description. Connecting wires to the tube appeared to be the logical first step, but proved a lot more difficult than expected. However, there's an easier way, but more about that later. I decided to start the wiring process with the cathode, which means the negative electrode. In order to identify which side is which, it's actually quite easy. You can consider the tube having an output side and an input side in quotation marks. The output side is where the laser light comes out, the water comes out, and where the electricity comes out, at least if you ignore the actual flow of electrons from the negative to the positive side and only consider the way it's usually shown in technical drawings, meaning the side where the light comes out is the cathode. After stripping and tinning some wire, I tried to tin the cathode, but it turns out that's where the problems start. The material is apparently very low in solderability. There is a workaround for that, which is to order a proper connector, but since I was impatient, I just switched to a smaller gauge wire that I could carefully wrap around the cathode and solder it at least in a way that I was convinced it was gonna hold up for a test fire. I then used some MG Chemicals 4226A insulating varnish on the exposed copper. Since the cathode is at ground potential during operations, this is technically not necessary, but it certainly doesn't hurt either. For added mechanical stability, which is probably also complete overkill on the cathode side, I added some heat shrink tubing, as well as a short bit of aquarium PVC tubing, and quite a bit of electrical tape to fix everything in place. A proper high voltage cable rated for up to 40 kilovolts was used on the anode side. The connection was established in essentially the same way shown before, but this time I was smart enough to use a flux pen to increase solderability, and even though this worked quite well, I would still highly recommend ordering a proper connector. A link is provided in the video description. This time a lot more care was taken applying the MG 4226A insulating varnish, and I actually applied multiple layers and allowed enough time for the previous layer to dry in between. The manufacturer promises a dielectric strength of 3 kilovolts per mil and a breakdown voltage of 5.5 kilovolts per mil. Just as a reminder, a mil is extremely small, 1/1000th of an inch or 0.025 millimeters to be, well, I wouldn't say precise because the last digit was rounded, but something in that general neighborhood. Just as before on the cathode side, I also used heat shrink tubing on the anode side to protect the anode, and a much thicker piece of silicon tubing for added mechanical stability and just to be sure that there's no such nasty things as dielectric breakdown happening. For some added safety and most importantly flexibility for some upcoming content on homebrew high voltage power supplies, I added a proper power connector to the end of the high voltage anode wire. I'll provide a link to this type of connector in the video description. Probably completely unnecessary, but certainly good in preventing any corona discharge, I also added some insulating varnish on the exposed metal inside the connector. The high voltage power supply used for the experiments shown in this video is a Vivor 50 watt CO2 laser power supply. The power supply did not come with the high voltage connector shown here, I installed that one off camera. The power supply was also not sponsored by Vivor in any way, I paid for it with my own money. The leftmost connector was connected to the 230 volt power supply, as well as to a current meter for low side sensing of the CO2 laser's operating current. The middle connector was connected to a 10 turn 10 kilo ohms potentiometer for power setting, as well as a few bridges for proper operation, although one of those is incorrect and I'll show that in a little bit. And lastly, the rightmost pin header was connected to a momentary switch to fire the laser, And just to make sure, since this is a low active input, I added a 10 kilo ohm pull-up resistor to the 5 volt supply rail to avoid any accidental fires. Just to recap from another perspective, this current meter will be connected to the cathode side of the CO2 laser tube. The potentiometer will be used to set the maximum output power of the laser tube, and the momentary switch will fire the laser. And here's a close-up view of the wiring for those of you following along at home. On the middle header, I marked my mistake. The third pin from the left actually has to be open, as both low active inputs are actually tied together internally. If this bridge is left in place, the laser will start firing the moment the power supply is connected to the mains, which I unfortunately found out the hard way. The laser tube and the power supply were mounted on my desk using a couple of laboratory stands, and the power supply was connected to the laser tube. While it is technically possible to fire the laser tube just like this, the tube won't be happy about it for all too long. That's because it requires water cooling for continuous operation. Since I want the laser tube to be happy and feel welcomed in my office, I connected both the water inlet and outlet with an hacked together adapter to some PVC tubing. For this test setup, I'm using a small aquarium pump for the cooling water and about 5 liters of distilled water. Regular tap water should not be used unless you are a fan of calcium buildup inside your laser tube. I should add that this method of cooling is sufficient for my very short tests. If continuous operation of the tube is desired, you would need an actual water cooler. The first time the pump is powered up, it might actually take quite some time for any air bubbles to be removed from the tube. In my case, it was necessary to turn and tilt the tube a little bit until all bubbles were able to escape. I allowed water to circulate through my setup for about an hour under close supervision, just to make sure that there's no water leaks anywhere that might cause problems later. After I was convinced that everything was sealed nicely, it was finally time to fire the laser. While I would have loved to show you the very first test firing, as you can see by the burn mark in the wood right at the beginning of the video, this was unfortunately not captured on camera. Remember my wiring mistake I pointed out earlier? Yeah, the laser tube fired immediately the moment I connected the power supply to the mains voltage. This kinda caught me off guard and brings up a very important point. Safety. When working with high-powered lasers, especially in experimental setups where you don't know how they behave, please wear appropriately rated safety goggles. With extremely high laser power such as this, even the mildest reflections are capable of permanently frying your retina. It is really fun to watch the laser tube and its beautiful purple glow during operation. Although I should mention that the glow isn't as intense in real life as it is on screen. That's because a camera is way more sensitive to infrared radiation than our human eyes are. Let's move on to some optical experiments. This is a rather expensive potassium titanyl phosphate crystal. It is a type of nonlinear crystal that's capable of frequency doubling infrared light at around 1060 nanometers to a beautiful green around 530 nanometers. And while I had a bad gut feeling about putting this crystal in this extremely powerful laser beam, well, I should have trusted my gut on this.
They ask you how you are, you just have to say that you're fine. And you're not really fine, but you just can't get into it because they would never understand.
The destruction of my KTP crystal did definitely not anger me. I did not resort to any unhealthy habits to resort this anger. I handled it like an adult. At least that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Next, it was time to actually focus the laser beam onto the wood. I'm using a meniscus lens and a proper lens holder from an optical bench, including the optical post, which conveniently clamps into the laboratory stands I used for the entire laser setup. After the destructive testing of my KTP crystal, I wanted to try these potassium dihydrogen phosphate crystals that I grew myself. They also exhibit nonlinear properties and are technically also capable of producing green light from infrared. Unsurprisingly, this yielded the same result as with the KTP crystal, however causing significantly less financial damage. If you have any good ideas of what to try next with this laser tube, please leave it in the comment section below. And if you liked this video, make sure you like, subscribe if you haven't already, and leave a comment to push the YouTube algorithm. Thanks and see you next time!